So I'm going to present the suggested rule, but now the final rule is out. And I have to disclaim. I have no financial disclaimers, but I have not looked at the final rule yet because no one has seen it. And as I am speaking, I am sure there are hundreds of people combing through this thing right now. What I did do was briefly look at CMS's executive summary, which is 24 pages long. What I'm going to try to do through my talk is to give little snippets of things that you may find interesting. I will tell you to look at the ACG macro tidbits. I'm sure that stuff is going to get posted today and throughout the week as we understand more about what this is about. It does appear to me, however, to make a global statement that CMS has heard us. They've heard our advocacy, and they want to try to make this work, and they understand how oppressive it is to physicians in practice. So with that, I want to jump into this. And what I'm going to do is to give you an overview of MACRA. This is not an intense explanation of the scoring system. That's very complex. I did download the 50-page PowerPoint from CMS on how the scoring system is supposed to work. I can't figure it out. Math was never my strong suit. I will be more than happy to show it to you and share it to you or send you the website if you give me my email. So let's jump into this. This does not seem to be working. Let me see. There we go. So here's what we're going to do. I'm going to go over background, I'm going to jump into MIPS, give you the overview, give you some take-home points, and then we'll try to summarize everything. So, by way of background, how did we get here? All right, so in 2009, HITECH was passed. That set the infrastructure for electronic medical records based on the Institute of Medicine's report dating back to 2000 that told us that we have a really bad system and we need to communicate better. Next came PPACA in 2010, which really did a number of things. It's caused a consolidation in the healthcare system, but it also set the stage for changing the way that we deliver medicine from fee-for-service to a value-based system. That then led the way for MACRA 2015, which pushed payment change, which is really why we're here. All right, so when you're talking about MACRA, which is the Medicare Access and CHIP Reauthorization Act, what it did basically was repeal the sustainable growth rate formula, which we all hated. This, recall, the sustainable growth rate was enacted as part of the 1997 Balanced Budget Act, which was given to us by Bill Clinton. We lived with that for 20 years. So whether you like MIPS and alternative payment models and MACRA or not, okay, our organizations were extremely vocal in repealing the SGR. And if you look at the penalties, if we stayed with the SGR versus what we have now, we actually are better off. MACRA basically has five titles to it. I did read it over. It's about 100 pages. Chapter one deals with the SGR and with payment reform. So let's delve into this a little bit. There are basically two major flavors when we talk about MACRA. One of them is alternative payment models. Costas is going to talk about that in a little bit. The other one is the merit-based incentive payment system, which from now on we will refer to as MIPS, and that's what we're going to talk about. So let's do it. January 1st, 2019, MIPS payment adjustment begins. That's firm. That's been confirmed as of today's rule. The final rule is supposed to be released in fall of 2016. Candidly, I was hoping that it would be released sometime this afternoon. I really did. And I've been going for the last month thinking to myself, it's going to be November 1st. It's going to be November 1st. It's going to be about the election. So with that prophecy, you can take everything else I say with that amount of credibility. So MIPS really applies to eligible providers. So who are those people? Those people are us, physicians assistants, nurse practitioners, CRNAs, and clinical nurse specialists. This is for 2019 and 2020. As of 2021, the secretary can then add on other people that they want to be eligible providers. Physicians, by the way, don't just include osteopaths and allopaths. They also include dentists, podiatrists, optometrists. It's just they use a global phrase, physicians. And what MIPS basically does is to consolidate these reporting systems that we have. So we all participate, I'm sure, most of us in the electronic health care record meaningful use. Remember, we originally did that so we could get meaningful use money, right? We're still reporting. We report on PQRS. We report for value-based purchasing. Those are going to get consolidated into one composite program. In addition, CMS has added an additional program called the Clinical Practice Improvement Activities. So these four categories are going to make up MIPS. So MIPS is going to be made up of four categories: quality, resource use, advancing care information, which was previously EHR meaningful use, and the Clinical Practice Improvement Activities. So now I'm going to throw some terms out at you that you will be very well versed with as time goes on, particularly in January 2019. You're going to hear about the composite score. A composite score is a score that is going to be your score on the total performance of those four categories of MIPS. It's developed by Medicare. You're going to be scored from 0 to 100. But it's not quite that easy, because it's not that each one of these categories is not assigned a point. There's a calculation in order to get the points for 0 to 100. Based upon the previous year's actual composite score, you will be paid for the following year. So for 2019, January 1st, which is when MIPS reimbursement starts, we will be paid based on data that is being submitted starting in January 2017. Okay, so they have this two-year phase-in. I'm going to touch base on that in a little bit. Providers will receive a quarterly score so that as the year goes on, you will not be in the dark. CMS wants transparency here, and they keep saying there's going to be transparency, and they're going to be giving you scores on each one of your categories to give you an idea of where you are and where you need to be in order to get not just reimbursed, but in order to either get an incentive that we're going to talk about or to be penalized that we're going to talk about. And if you do very, very well and you get a positive bonus, you may actually be eligible for an additional bonus, which I'm going to tell you how that works in a minute. There we go. So CMS is going to set this thing called the threshold point. The threshold point is going to be the point where you will be compared, your composite score will be compared against it. And basically the way it'll work is if you hit the threshold point, you will be paid, but you will not be penalized. You also will not get a bonus. Okay, but you will get to that threshold point. Your composite score is going to be made up of four aggregate scores. So where do the aggregate scores come from? Your aggregate score will come from each one of your categories. So each category will have an aggregate score. Your aggregate score will be totaled, and then you will get your composite score. And this will be compared to the target score that CMS comes up with. So where does the target score come from? CMS will look at all the providers, see how they're doing, and they're going to come up with a number that they think that you need to hit, okay? And based on that number, you will know how you're doing, and you will be compared to everyone else. The idea being that we are competitive, and that if we are looking and seeing what our other gastroenterologists are doing, we're falling behind it, we will try to make efforts in the particular category that we're behind in order to do better and to produce something of better value and more efficient cost. Again, we're moving from a fee-for-service model to a beyond value-based purchasing to this merit-based incentive program. That's what this is. So I told you that the composite score is going to be somewhere between 0 to 100. I can tell you that CMS, under the new report, has arbitrarily set 70 as the magic number for their threshold score for 2019. Okay, so if you read through the summary, the 24-page summary that I just kind of eyeballed, 70 is the magic number. So anybody that hits a threshold of 70 will be zeroed out. You will get paid, and you will not be penalized. I'm going to talk more about penalizing and bonusing in a minute. Just hang with me. There's a lot here. So I told you that there are four weighted performance categories. Those are your red bullets, okay? Quality measures, resource use measures, advancing care information, and clinical improvement activities. Each one of these is going to be weighted differently. If you look at the yellow bullets, it will give you the percentages. These percentages of weight change over time. I'm going to give you that in another slide, okay? But basically, quality measures is what used to be PQRS. What used to be PQRS? The quality score is extremely important. It's going to count for 50%, half, of your composite score for 2019 and 45% for 2020. Okay? Another thing that came out of the firm rule, because there's been a lot of pushback from the medical organizations, particularly the ACG, advocating for us, gastroenterologists, that this is a very difficult rule for us to make. There are 9 parameters here that need to be reported on. CMS is going to give us 3. So the rule said CMS understands they've heard us. They're only going to count 1 quality measure for 2019 in order to get your quality score. They're going to give us 3, and we're only going to have to choose 1 to report on instead of 6. Then there's the second one is the resource use measure. So this is not going to be weighted as heavily. It's only going to be, it can't be more by statute than 10% for 2019, 15% for 2020. And CMS is developing a program in order to do this. CMS has said that they're actually going to give us this in 2019. You're going to get a free point for this, okay? Advancing care information, this has to do with our electronic healthcare systems. I'm going to show you in a moment when we delve into each one of these 4 categories, which I will do towards the end of my talk to give you a better feel. You will see the reporting for EHR for this advancing care information will not be as arduous as EHR meaningful use was. And finally, clinical improvement activities. These are subcategories that CMS is developing. It's going to be 15% of the score. I want to call your attention to something that's very important. GI Quick. Okay, now, let me disclaim. I am not on GI Quick. I just signed up for GI Quick. All right, GI Quick will give you a double whammy. Okay, you will get points if you are in any accepted registry. So if you are in GI Quick, you will get points for the quality measure and also for clinical improvement activities. I have been told by the ACG leadership that GI Quick has applied to become an approved registry under MIPS and up for APMs, and I am told that it looks like that's going to go through. So I'm very happy about that. I'm stalling here. Can we advance the slide? Yeah, okay. Perfect. So all that this is a representative graph of what I told you. It takes the years, and it takes the 4 categories, and it tells you how the weighting changes, okay? But you can see clearly that advancing care information, the EHR component of this, and quality are going to make up a significant amount of the score moving forward. Now, again, I'm putting this up here. I don't know if these are firm percentages. And CMS has already told us that for quality, for 50%, they're giving us a gimme for 2019. Andy Slavitt did make a comment this morning, okay? And the comment is that we heard you, basically. I'm paraphrasing. I should have gone into government, and I probably should get paid what Andy Slavitt gets paid to tell people what to do. But basically, he basically said that he heard us, that we need to make this work, that this is all about improving patient care, but also protecting and understanding providers and what we need. So he's alleging that CMS is going to have an open discussion. He's put Dr. Agarwal, who's in charge of program integrity, who I've actually met and been involved with at some of the other healthcare compliance association organizations that I'm involved with, some of the medical legal organizations. They are extremely committed to making it work. They understand that physicians are fed up and are stressed out over all of these changes and requirements. All right, I think I went back there. I don't know what we're doing here. There we go. There we go. So anyway, this is what really razzed everybody up, and I think that this is why CMS backed down. CMS came out with a statement a couple of months ago that about 60% of eligible GIs are going to get a bonus, but about 40% of physicians are going to be cut. And they said that if practices of 100 or more physicians are going to do well, and the smaller the practice, the worse they're going to do. So that really outraged everyone, every medical organization, not just the GI organizations. And there was this big outcry that this is completely intolerable. You're pushing people out of private practice, and you're trying to destroy private medicine and small medical groups. Okay? So there have been a bunch of changes. I'm going to show you some of them. And I think that that is why CMS has softened with this final release of MIPS and all that they're trying to do. And then again, you know, we talked about these sliding cuts. This button here? Oh, okay. Okay. This, again, there's no reason to spend time on this. Again, I've graphed out the way the percentage of cuts go. For 2019, the minimum cut will be 4%. The maximum bonus will be something like 4 to 12%. It's really going to be 4 and 4%. And then there's other ways of figuring bonuses that I'm not going to go into right now. But you can see that as we get up to 2022 and beyond, The penalties really get really pretty significant. I speak all over the country on this stuff. I mean, I'm going to lay it right out there for you. I meet physicians in practice in multiple states, and I hear a number of physicians handling this different ways. Particularly baby boomer physicians plan to not do, they're not on electronic healthcare records, they're going to retire in a couple of years. And if you're here for my 2 o'clock talk, I'll give you some data on that. So there's different ways of handling this, but if you're in the game, this is a real program, the bonuses and the cuts are quite significant. This MIPS is based on budget neutrality, so for people to get bonuses, people have to lose money, physicians have to lose money. So there must be a lower score of providers in order to have bonus money available, okay? There are payment thresholds. The language in MACRA allows the secretary to adjust positive payment percentages by this thing called the scaling factor. It's very complex. It can't exceed 3 times what the base is. I'm not going to go into it. I have not looked through the MACRA. I keep saying that. I'm obviously insecure about it and presenting to you, so I don't know how this is going to be affected. Now, exceptional performance bonus. Because of the outrage of the comment from CMS that about 40% or so of physicians are going to be to get a negative payment because of MIPS if you're a smaller practice, the government decided that they had to do something. So what they did was to pass a law that will give $3 billion over 6 years. So every year for 6 years, there's going to be $500 million available as additional bonus money for physicians and practices that perform above a certain top performance level. That has nothing to do with budget neutrality. No one has to lose money to get this. And about $13 million a year of that $500 million is going to go to GI. The bonus has been capped at 10%. So even if you're an eligible provider, the most you can get is 10% of that bonus money. And it's going to go to the top 25 providers. So Costa, I thank Costas for this chart, but this basically gives you an idea. But if you look at the graph all the way up at the top that says top 25% of providers at threshold of score of 100, okay, those are the group, that's the group in that quartile, if you will, that is going to be eligible for the extra bonus. Now, you know, we talked about the threshold point, okay, we know that threshold point is set at 70, okay, because that's what it is in the CMS report that just came out. So not everybody has to participate in MIPS, okay, so maybe you are one of these people. CMS estimates that there's basically 1,849, not 1,850, not 1,848, but 1,849 GI physicians that are going to be excluded from MIPS. So who are these individuals? Newly Medicare enrolled eligible physicians, so if you're first year in practice of Medicare Part B, low volume threshold, less than $10,000 in billable claims, less than 100 Medicare patients. I want to know who these people are. They must be in some college town, and it must be a new startup college. Actually, there has been some suggestion, and again, I refer you to the final rule if there is language, that this parameter actually be increased to like 250 Medicare patients and something like $50,000 to $100,000 in billables. So I don't know the way that's going to pan out, but this was based on the presumed rule. Qualified alternative practice models, whether they're full or partial, are excluded. Costas is going to talk about that in a few minutes, or as I'm looking at the timer, in a few seconds. I wanted to delve into each one of the categories, but again, the rule has changed, so I'm really going to pass over this. The four categories. One is quality. It's similar to PQRS. GI Quick will get you credit. It's heavily weighted. It was 50% for 2019, 45% for 2020. I told you that you're going to get one category is all that's going to be weighted. That's the one thing that I know. It's going to be derived from the claims starting in 2017 for reporting period. It's going to measure these things called acute conditions composite, chronic condition composite, and all-cause hospital readmission measures. So we're already reporting on some of this stuff. Now you're going to be graded on it. And CMS holds the ultimate authority. There's the resource rule. It only gives you 10% of the weight of the composite score. It's basically the cost of providing care. You will be compared across your peers. Right now, CMS is trying to identify, and they're working with the GI organizations to identify different diseases, if you will, to look at relative resource use. They're looking at the cost of treating and following colonic diverticulitis, cholecystitis, cholecystectomy with biliary intervention, which is a new one that's not listed there, and or colonoscopy with biopsy. CMS is proposed a 20-patient minimum sample, but what they've decided to do is that if you can't meet that 20-patient minimum, they're just going to throw out the entire resource score, and they're going to put more weight in a different category. Advancing care information is IT. They're getting away, as I already told you, to the burdensome reporting. They're really interested in IT functionality. What is your EHR doing? Are you doing electronic prescribing, for example, and interoperability? Are you communicating with other systems? Are you communicating with other physicians? Do you have an active portal? Are you emailing your patients? Are you communicating? Are you posting results? And again, I've got what makes up the different scoring systems printed out. It's beyond the scope of this talk. Finally, clinical practice improvement activities. This category improves a number of categories that CMS has come up with. They have 90 proposed options. Next year, they say they're going to publish more. You're going to have 150 things to choose from, and you will choose things like how quickly a patient can get an appointment, for example. It's a lot of the quality parameters. It really goes to the weight of the four-part article that I had the pleasure of co-authoring through the earlier this year, the four-part series in the Red Journal with Lou Wilson and Jay Yapuri, thanks to Mike Morelli's help and guidance. So this is a 15% weighted area. CMS eased the macro requirements, okay, so this was their phase back down. It sounds scary if you're going to jump into MIPS. You do not have to jump in at 100%. Okay, CMS will use the calendar year 2017 as the reporting for 2019. You're going to have four options. The test option is where, number one, is where you can submit some data for MIPS after January 1st, and you will not get cut in 2019. So you're not going to be penalized if you only submit some data. You can do a partial year participation, so you can start reporting in January 17, but you don't have to report the entire year or everything. You can go full speed ahead. If you're all ready to rock and roll with MIPS, then go for it, and then you may be eligible for a modest bonus, or you can just participate in an APM, which is your segue. And the final rule is released by November 1st, 2016, so you know how reliable that bullet is. So I tried to run through this quickly. I hope I gave you an overview. I refer you to my slides, but most importantly, I refer you to the link that's going to be posted shortly. These are our take-home points. The U.S. healthcare system is changing from fee-for-service to value-based system. It's not changing. It's changed. Okay, we're in the transition. Data is already being collected. Adjustments begin January 1st and 19. It's compromised of the four performance categories. Each one is weighted differently. You're going to have a score. It's going to be compared. We know that threshold number now is 70 for 2019. It will change every year. Bonuses and penalties are directly related to reaching the threshold score. Participation in a qualified clinical database is going to be very helpful. And just stay tuned. We'll see where we are. Thank you very much. I appreciate your attendance.